Denny's got a word he wants to share with us. Come on, Denny. Now, folks, this is what I'm talking about. The Lord's giving you something. You stand up and say it.
First, though, I want to thank Gary and Shannon for that awesome worship. You know, in between songs, I just close my eyes and I concentrate on the Lord, and it just helps the flow, you know, to keep my eyes on Him. And I just love you. I love you all's worship. Thank you so much. Such a blessing. I don't know what I wished all of you could have been here. I don't know, some of you didn't make it for the whole week. We missed a day ourselves, but when Lewis was here, I just, you know, he shared so much, and it was just the basics, you know. And we got his book. Let me see that book, Pam. It's right there. It says The New You. Most of you have already seen this, but the reason I want to show it to you is he ran out of books, and but you can get this on Amazon Kindle app. I think it's like $4.95, and it's worth five times that. I mean, he covers the basics, and you know, I'm halfway through it, and it's just blessing my socks off. So much so that Saturday morning, I got up and I couldn't get that jingle out of my head that Gary plays. How's that go, Gary? You are my joy, Lord. Only I found coming out of my mouth is, you are my life, Lord. You are my life, Lord. You are my life. And I sang that for probably 2 hours. All day, Pam says, you know. And I mean, it's just bubbling over in me. And so I was at the kitchen sink yesterday morning, and because we were here most of the week, I got so far behind on chores. And, you know, I talked to the Lord about that, and I said, Lord, you know, you're my life, and I want you to live your life through me today. So I'm just going to give this to you, and I'm going to let you prioritize things. Well, one of the things I needed to get done was to go down to my son's and take down a tree that he had promised his landlord that he would do by the end of the month. Well, yesterday was the 1st of April, and I thought, well, you know, I got to get that done today, and then I've got to get our water heater fixed. It wasn't working correctly, and so on and so forth. So just after I had prayed that, I'm at the sink, and I turned around, and I looked into the dining area, and there was a calendar there. And this particular calendar has President Reagan on his ranch and different scenes and everything, his everyday life on the ranch. But it was still on March. And I thought, well, I'll just turn that over. So I walked over there, and I turned it over, and wouldn't you just know that there was President Reagan with a chainsaw in his hand cutting a tree down. And I said, well, Lord, you don't have to hit me over the head. I guess I need to spend some time with my son today, you know. So I just want to encourage you. He hears our prayers, and he hears the cries of our heart. And that just, you know, he does stuff like that to me all the time, and I just get so blessed.
Amen. Amen. Way to go, Chuck. All right, you know. Thanks, Denny. Oh, me. Oh, my. Before we get started, and I forget, Easter Sunday is coming up. Now, we're going to do something really different next Sunday. Okay? All right. Next Sunday's not Easter. We're going to do something really significant next Sunday, okay? Then the Sunday of Easter. What we're going to do next Sunday is we're going to celebrate communion. And so come, be ready, start preparing. Then Easter Sunday morning, we're going to do something different to celebrate Easter, the resurrection of our Lord. That's all I'm going to tell you. We're going to do something different. But next Sunday, we're going to do communion. And the Lord showed me that after I got here this morning and after I printed these up. But I just wanted to point that out to you in case something hits me and I go, oh, I forgot to tell them about communion. And so next Sunday, just come ready to get your communion is a good starting place. It's a good beginning place. It's a good place that God gives Christians, I believe, to. It's a good healing place for what's ever going on in your heart and your family. It's a good healing place for forgiveness and understanding and relationships. It's a good place for a lot of healing and mending to take place. So I wanted to get that in. I really want to encourage you to go on this hike with us. It's a four-wheel drive there, and the drive itself is an adventure. Then when you get there, it just goes uphill. Denny, 100 yards, for maybe 100 yards it goes uphill. But it's not hard uphill. A couple hundred yards. Anyway, it's not. Then once you go the first couple hundred yards, that's all the climbing you're going to do. And then you start walking right out to these beautiful vistas. And so I'm going to come manned with Derek's camera next time to get your lens and to get those, maybe get those. I was, there you go. Sophie came up to me last week at some point and asked this question. Is God a king or a life coach? You know, I thought that was, you know, guys, you need to understand something. That girl's 11 years old. She doesn't look 11 because she's got her daddy's height and her mother's height. She's just 11. No. And she came up to me. She said, Pastor Gary, is God a king or a life coach? I looked at her and I said, yes. God is a king. God has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, though of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Yes, Sophie, Jesus is King. And because of his sacrifice on the cross and given his life, not only for us, but as us, and now we have His life living in and through us, we will forever bow down to Him as Lord. But guys, God is also a life coach. If you'll take a look up here at Jeremiah 29:11, for I know, God says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Isn't it amazing how often we're afraid to give our lives over to the Lord because we're afraid what He might ask us to do. Or He may make me go to deepest, darkest Africa. You know, or, you know, He's going to call me to want to do this or to do that. You know, and, you know, but listen, if my future and your future is known, why don't you want to know what it is? It's not a future you're going to hate. You know, when I was at Howard Payne University, me and Betty Brewer went to Howard Payne University. She was there just a little before me, about 50 years. And it's literally 50 years. And Howard Payne University's in Brownwood, Texas. And Cindy, you know, we called it Old Main, you know, that main office building there at Howard Payne. Betty called it New Main. They just built that. I know she just built that when she. Old Main was the big office building, big beautiful building, called Old Main, New Main to Betty, we read about Thomas Jefferson. Betty knew Thomas Jefferson. But that's okay, isn't it, Betty? Yeah. You know, reason I bring that up is I had a guy I went to school with, and I don't remember his name, which I'm probably sure he doesn't remember my name. He might, I don't know. He may have a better memory than me. But I remember we were talking about how he just could not wait to get to New York City to start his ministry. And I said, yuck. Are you serious? He said, yeah. He says, Gary, where did you think God may be sending you? He says, I'm praying he sends me to mountains. And then we got to talking and we thought, you know, isn't that interesting how God plants in us these different desires so that we will go where he tells us to go? I don't know what you're afraid of. I really don't know what you're afraid of. I mean, why are we running from our future? You know, why are we running from the things that God has for us? It's not like, you remember the story of the Cyclops, that old fable? They had the one eye. You remember the curse of the Cyclops? Anybody remember the curse of the Cyclops? What was it, Steve? I thought it was the other way around. But the future was their death. He could see the death. You know, and I think that's what we're afraid of. We don't want to know. One thing we could be afraid of is I don't want to know the future because I could see my death. Well, can I go ahead and shock you? You're going to die. Let's go ahead and get that out of the way. You know, but what God's talking about isn't something that we should be fearful of, isn't something that we should look for with intrepidation. It's something that we should yearn. Yes, he is a life coach. He is wanting to show us what he's got for us, how we're going to be playing a big part in his kingdom. You know, and that's true. In his kingdom purpose, we play a big part in that. See, but as you know, God's a king. And you know, Sophie is so cute. Is he a king or a life coach? Yes and yes, but he's also more than that. He's more than we can talk about this morning, okay? But I do want to talk about one more thing that God is, and that God is a shepherd. When life knocks me down, Jesus picks me up. You know, that just might be one of my favorite pictures of Jesus. Anybody ever seen that before? That just, you can put me in that picture. And that just might be who you need Jesus to be for you this morning. This life down here, we don't call it the school of hard knocks for no reason. And sometimes we can get up, hit upside the head so many times. How many of you ever got your head hit? I slipped for the very first time this winter in 8 years living in North Idaho. I was deceived. How many of you ever been deceived? I was deceived. I had forgotten a tremendous principle around here and it in the winter. And it from the South, you have to train yourself the North Idaho winter principles. And let me just tell you what I mean. We had a lot of snowing and melting. And melting. Like it would get up to about like 33 and melt for a few days. Then we'd get a lot more snow. Well, I walked outside after a few of those cycles, and I had forgotten that underneath that beautiful blanket of snow was what? Was ice on my sidewalk. You see, guys, sometimes life is real good about disguising what's, you know, on the surface it's light and fluffy, but when you step into it, whoops, that's ice. Well, I didn't think about it. I forgot what I was doing out there. Taking the trash out. Yeah. Yeah. And I took a step right onto that sidewalk, and my feet came flying right out from under me, and I landed on my back, and then I felt my head hit, and lights just went off. You seen the lights? Oh, my goodness. See, I'd never done that before, because usually I'm pretty good about going, okay, now what's the rule? You know, that may be snow, but that may be something. You know, I'm usually pretty good about that. Because in the South, in the wintertime, you walk out, your sidewalk looks just like it did in the summertime. I mean, there's no rules to have to get, I call them shoe chains. You know, you get these things that wrap around your feet and help you. Yeah, those are good, too. You can get them. They're gone now. But next year, if you need some, Black Sheep had them for $6 a pair, and they're good. One. Well, he can get them and last him twice as long. Okay, all right. You know, but I'm telling you, you're stunned. And the first thing you do is kick yourself that you didn't remember the rule, but you lay there and all of a sudden you get this goose egg, and you know what I'm talking about. You know, I'm just thank God it was under my hair instead of right here. Well, you'd have seen this, you know, right here. I've been a cyclops. You know, and I remember having to get up dazed. And guys, you know, it took me a little while to recover. And then I noticed that I had muscles pulled all in the front of me, because when I landed, my body's first reaction is to coil up. And I noticed that I couldn't hardly move, get up and out of bed, because these muscles here. I had no idea. I didn't know until the next day how much I was hurt. Well, folks, I'm telling you, things can happen in your life to where you are just hurt. You're just hurt. There's no other way to explain it except you're hurt. And I would have loved it if I thought Cindy could have helped me out of Calder. Cindy wasn't going to be able to help me up. She'd have just got worried. She'd probably called an ambulance, which that was not necessary. But I got up, and I felt, you know. And some of you may be fallen, and you're still hurting. You know, I love these are more views of the hike. That's the easiest one we do. But Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you." So what's the advice? Don't let your heart be troubled. Neither let them, he's talking to his disciples, be afraid. Paul says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Tell him, Father, I'm hurting. You're not telling him anything he doesn't know. What you're doing is you're acknowledging your hurt and your pain to him, and you're acknowledging that you cannot pick yourself up. Then the peace of God, which transcends all earthly understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Pretty cool, huh? 1 Peter 5:7. Would you read this with me? Cast all your cares upon Him, because He cares for you. Aren't you glad that Jesus is a caring shepherd, that He's always counting the sheep and He knows when one's gone? And He'll leave the 99 to come get you. There's a song that I asked Gary to come help me with this morning. And I want this to be our prayer. After we sing this song, I've got a guided meditation from Psalm 23. You see, because I don't know if you had a chance to read my Facebook post this morning on the Freedom Fellowship site. How many of you know that there are times you have to wait on the Lord? How many of you know that you don't have to wait for His peace to come? There may be a lot of things you have to wait on God's timing for, but His peace is not one of them. His peace is with you. He said, "It's my peace I leave for you." It's not the kind of peace the world gives. It's only based on your circumstances and how you feel about the moment. See the Final Four yesterday? Man, you missed it. That was the best Final Four in college basketball I may have seen in quite a while. Although I was really pulling for Oregon, and they just came up a point short. But you notice what happened at that game, if you watched it? Boy, the South Carolina fans, they were just hooping and hollering. If they showed them when the camera was on. You know, you're a college kid. You know, pulling their South Carolina, see my South Carolina shirt. At the end of the game, when Gonzaga beat South Carolina, that same bunch had lost their joy. Do you know why? Because they anchored their joy in something that was very circumstantial. They anchored their joy in something that is fleeting. Did you know how many teams play in that tournament now? 4,012? How many? 60? 68? Let me tell you a very depressing thought. Out of 68 teams that go to that tournament, 67 of them are going to leave sad. Aren't you glad that God's different? And that our peace doesn't have to depend on the Falcons winning the Super Bowl. Huh? And Brady will retire one day, buddy. Don't you, Lane? Don't you know? Give the rest of us a chance. And I'll tell you, Derek, I remember the days of John Smoltz and Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux. And when the Braves seemed like they would never lose again. No. They're losing. When you cast all your cares upon Christ, you can count on it being taken care of, and His peace will be everlasting. Y'all know this song? If you don't, we're going to learn it. Just sit right there. You ready, Gary? I cast all my cares upon You. I lay all of my burdens down at Your feet. And any time I don't know what to do, I will cast all my cares upon You. Do it again. I cast all my cares upon You. I lay all of my burdens down. I've got the 23rd Psalm up there in phrases. You can look at the screen if you'd like, or you can close your eyes. But isn't that a beautiful picture? I don't know where that is. I just saw it and I said, man, I like that. It's got to be up here somewhere. I just hadn't seen it yet. You know, what I'm going to do is, Gary continues to play, if you don't mind, is I'm going to read, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," and then I want you to repeat it after me. And we're going to go through each phrase. Now, here's what I want you to do. If you want to close your eyes and sit next to that stream for a while, I'm going to say it, then you're going to repeat it. But if you want to look at that screen, that's beautiful too. But here's what I want to happen. I don't believe we give God time to soak into come and to reach those deepest parts of our soul. And this is what basically all we're going to do is meditate on Scripture. Now, in between some of the quotes, I may say a word or two. But whatever you have to do to get into your little soul world, whether it be eyes open, eyes shut, but wait for me to say the phrase, and then you all repeat it after me, okay? Let's try it. Okay, get in your little soul world. Get into your heart. Get into the places where you need Christ to touch you. Get into the hurts. Get into the pain. Get into the areas, the dark places that maybe you haven't been able to, you haven't let His light shine. And get into those worries and those anxieties. And let Christ just minister to the deepest part of you today. Here we go. Just repeat after me as I say the phrases. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. Gary, keep playing. We're going to stop right here. Let the Lord restore your soul this morning. Restorer of the souls. Restorers of our soul. Touch our hearts at the deepest place where we need you this morning. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Let's say that again, guys. We're going to go back. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Wait a minute. You, Pastor Gary, you mean to tell me that goodness and mercy can be mine? You mean to tell me that in the midst of all that I've experienced in my life, and you mean to tell me that in the midst of all that's gone wrong, you mean that in the midst of all my mistakes, you mean to tell me that from this point forward, regardless of what my circumstances are, that I can feel the goodness of God and live in His mercy the days of all the days of my life? The answer to that question, class, is what? Yes. This is not something you need to wait for. This is not something that you need to do penance over. This isn't something you need to beat yourself up for in order to receive, folks. The peace of God that passes all understanding is there for us to just take. It's just there for us to receive. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. All right, look up here. Now, you should have cleared out a lot of spiritual cobwebs. You should have made room for the Spirit to work. So I want to share with you a little bit about spiritual warfare. Stay with me. We talked about last week some battlefields that we fight. But one of the biggest battlefields that you are in every single day, and if you want to keep playing, you can, but you don't have to, but you can. You know, the battlefields that you and I fight every day is the battlefield of the mind. That immediately when we leave this peaceful place, that when you leave this peaceful place that you are in your soul, you're going to walk out that door. And you're going to forget all about it. Why? Because we got to understand. I've got lines I'm drawing. I want you to stay with me. You see, if you want, you will keep him in perfect peace when your mind is stayed on him. Discipline your mind, because what you're doing is you're building trust in God. I know this may sound crazy. Because God is God, and God doesn't need to prove himself to anybody, but stay with me. We do need him to prove himself to us. Stay with me. We need to put God, we need to put ourselves in such a place of abandonment before him that he wants us to do that. So he can prove to us he's trustworthy. That happens? Oh, yeah. If you'll take a look at Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, this is in reference to the tithe. He says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Then what does he say? Test me in this. Let me show you that if you will place your trust in me, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven. And pour out such a blessing that there'll be not enough room to store. Do you know why you're cleaning out the cobwebs? Do you know why you're cleaning out the rooms of your soul? You're making room for the spiritual stuff that God wants to give you so much of that you're going to run out of space. Yeah. For a lot of us, we're just not so sure that we can trust God. For example, here, if I tithe, if I really gave 10% of my money, if I really did that, this is just an example. You can take it in any area, but this is the context of Malachi. That if I fully trust God with my children, if I fully trust God with my marriage, if I fully trust God with my job, or how he's going to take care of me. If I fully trust in, here's what you need to do. You need to build a track record of trust. And it starts by trusting him right now and then watching him take care of your need. Now, there's something you can do right now. Seriously. In the context of this verse, you can write a check for 10%. Or you can say, God, there's this situation I'm dealing with in my home, in my life. I'm going to quit trying to fix that. And my check that I'm going to write to you, and if you want to, you can write it out yourself. I trust God with my... Put it in the offering box. Give it to the Lord. And what will happen is that God will fill you. In other words, do something right now to begin to see if God is true. that if I truly, with a pure heart, will do something of faith that requires me to trust Him, will He come through? The answer is yes. It is yes. Then you will start to walk in the newness of life that Lewis talked about this week. And this isn't an act of works. This is an act of faith. Follow me? It's an act of faith. How many of you, when you started tithing, you didn't know if God would take care of you? Anybody willing to admit that? Has He ever not taken care of you? Have you ever been short for anything? And so you've got a track record now. So when you go home, you've got a track record. You see what begins to happen? Then what you do, Betty, you pass it down to your children and your grandchildren. Let me show you how to trust the Lord. Let me show you how to trust the Lord. You pass it on to those you begin to mentor. Let me show you how to trust the Lord. And guys, a lot of times we don't put ourselves in position for God to really do something because we're still holding on to it ourselves. The reason I'm saying, whether it's a check or whether you write out on a piece of paper, God, today I give you what? And if you'll sign it and put it in that offering box, Jim will give it to me, and I will join you in prayer and help and trusting with you that God will do that. God, I give to you today my marriage. God, I give to you today my children. God, I give you today my situation. God, I give you today my finances. If you want to have the faith in the finances, God, I give you today 10% of my income. Whatever it is, put it in that offering as a symbolic gesture of you're not taking this home. Is this making sense? And then we'll trust the Lord together. And then what will happen is that He will keep you in perfect peace. Then your mind will be stayed on Him and you'll be building up a bank of trust with God. And He'll show you He'll take care of you. Remember what the scripture says? I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging for bread. Amen. Wow. Stand with me and let's pray. You know, Father, I tell you, one of the things you showed me in Manifest was that I don't need to try to manipulate you. I don't need to try to manipulate others. I don't need to try to make Jesus happen. What you've taught me, Father, is that my name is no longer manipulation. My name is Manifest. And that, Father, all I want is for you to manifest your power and your will and your way in my life. I want you to manifest your spirit. And, Father, I understand that if I'm going to keep holding on to and trying to make my family work, how can you do that? If I'm going to hold on and try to keep making my finances work, I can't hold on to it and give it to you. Father, today, help us to begin to trust totally and completely in you. May our minds be stayed on you. We're not going to walk out the door and leave you here today, Father. We're taking you home. We're taking your presence with us. Father, may our lives be just an exercise in the practice of your presence. Father, may we be aware of your presence in our lives all the time, trusting you all the time, trusting you with everything. And then as we begin to trust you with these things that we're leaving in the offering box today, Father, then just maybe over this week, things just might start changing. My mindset just might be different. My situation just might start getting better. I don't know. It may get worse for a while. I don't know. But God, I do know this, that if we will trust you with all our heart, and if we'll lean not on our own understanding, that you will direct our paths. You will show us your ways. You will, Father, you have a future to prosper us. You have a future, Father, to make us everything you've made us to be. I want to know what that is. I want to walk in it. I want to step in it. I want it to become real in me and my family's lives. Teach us to trust you, Father, and that the peace of God will flood our souls. And we don't have to wait on that. We can just obey now. We can just let you have it now. And I don't have to wait another second. Oh, Lord Jesus, may we give it to you and truly, truly, truly know you and know the peace that you give. Father, as we go home today, we leave in your love and with this little song on our minds. Gary, let's do it. I cast all my cares upon you. This will be our closing prayer. I cast all my cares upon you. I lay all of my burdens down at your feet. And anytime I don't know why, will cast all my cares upon you. The summer calendar's here, and we're having the family camp out June 1st through 4th. That's going to be at Green Bay. Mindy, we don't do a vacation Bible school. It's going to be a week or a weekend. Okay, good. And the Alaska mission trip has turned in, looks like, is turning into me going, which is good. And but I'll be telling you, that's going to be, if you're still thinking you're interested, you need to come see me, because there's some circumstances behind that you need to know before you make that decision. Prayer meeting Wednesday, 30. And if you guys have not been to our prayer meetings, we really want to encourage you to come at 6:30 Wednesday evening. Oh, did you notice the manifest offering? Did you notice that? $840. Lewis and Lou went home with $1,840. Nice. Isn't that amazing? That's fantastic. Or they went to Seattle. Hope they don't spend it all in one place. You know, but $1,800. That'll probably be 2 weeks' rent over there. Anyway, but the so thank you so much for your giving. That was so great that we blessed them that way. And so I just want to thank you so much for all that you're doing and everything that God's doing through you. I appreciate you so much. All right, Cindy, is that good? All right. All right, well, then that's it. You are dismissed. Thank you so much for coming this morning.